5 seasons, the Jadeveon Clowney experiment is officially over in Houston. The team traded the 3-time Pro Bowl defensive end to the Seahawks on Saturday, and Bart is applauding. In a separate move, the Texans acquired first-round left tackle Laremy Tunsil and wide receiver Kenny Stills from Miami. Nick, did Houston get better after this weekend?
Yes, they got better. They got better. They added a guy that one day might be an all-pro, like might be one of the top 5 tackles in football. I don't think he is yet, but one day might be. It was their biggest position of need. But the price they paid was so enormous. Like, just set the Clowney trade aside for a second. They traded 2 firsts and a second for Laremy Tunsil.
Yes.
Listen. The best analogy I come up with is this. The Texans, everyone's known they've needed an offensive line for 2 years now, right? So you move to a new city and you're like, I'm not going to buy a car. Everyone's like, no, you need a car. Now, first year on the job, I'm going to take mass transit. You're late for work all the time, almost get fired. And then you tell your friends, you're like, you know what? Finally, listen, you guys bought a car. Oh, what'd you get? I got an Acura. They're like, oh, it's a little nicer than I thought you'd get. What'd you pay? $145,000. But don't worry. For That's 6 months, but no great. Money down for 6 months. Right. So eventually, listen, the cost, the bill will come due. Poor Deshaun Watson last year had a collapsed lung. Had to take bus trips instead of plane rides.
He needs an offensive line.
I get why they did it, but one of my former colleagues in Houston, former Houston Texan, Seth Payne, made this point. Like, after the housing crisis happened, and you didn't want to bail out the banks, but because of your bad decisions, you swallowed hard and did it. The Texans had to bail out Deshaun Watson because of years of bad decisions. They put themselves in a position where Miami can hold them over a barrel like this. So, yeah, they're better because they got a left tackle where they needed it. But that cost, Bart, is enormous. And that's before we even discuss just giving away Jadeveon Clowney.
I don't know about just giving him away. They got Mingo back, who's been a disappointment, but he's not a slouch. He's okay. I think we overvalue, to me, what Jadeveon Clowney is. I think sometimes we want to put him in the same, you know, the same category as Von Miller. We want to put him in Khalil Mack. He's not that. He's closer to Mario Williams. He's a guy that you're going to look up at the end of the year. He's going to have 9-10 sacks. I look at his career sack high. It's the same as mine as a middle linebacker. I'm not paying $150 million for that. He's a guy that's tremendous in setting the edge, and he's disruptive, but he's not getting the sacks that you want or the production that you get, really, we see from the elite inside to interior tackles. You know, you look at the guy on this team, J.J. Watt, you look at Aaron Donald, what he gives you, he's not giving you near that type of production. So you had to let him go. And I love the fact that you're able to protect Deshaun Watson, because I think this is them being all in. And really, the move that I really like the most is Kenny Stills. Because what happens
in the Tunsil?
So Kenny Stills is one of the most electric deep threats outside of Deshaun Watson, as far as Deshaun Jackson, in a long time. And what happens is every year when you see Deshaun Watson struggle is because he loses Will Fuller.
Yep.
Will Fuller is a guy that's tremendous, that's going to stretch the field, because we know Hopkins is more of a possession type of guy. So now you're able to put in Duke Johnson, who's somebody who's a tremendous pass catching running back. So now you have electric playmakers all around Deshaun Watson. I love it, and I love the insurance that Stills brings to this team.
All right, so a couple things. Let me talk about Clowney for a second, because I think you're a little too far down on Clowney. Clowney is an elite run defender. That doesn't show up in the sack stats.
Okay.
They also can move him all over the line. He can play every position on the defensive line. And the injury bug, which was obviously a big part early in his career.
Microfracture.
He's missed 3 games in the last 3 years. He seems to have gotten over that, at least to a degree. But the bigger problem with the Texans is the process here. There were 3 pass rushers who were franchise tagged at the end of the season. Dee Ford, Frank Clark, Jadeveon Clowney. Frank Clark went for a first and a second. Mm-hmm. Dee Ford went for a second because they were traded before the July 15th deadline, so the teams that were trading for him could sign him to an extension. The Texans, as you often do when you don't have a general manager, could not figure out what they were doing, thought Clowney was bluffing, and they ended up trading away Clowney for 30 cents on the dollar. There was a time, I'm sure you both remember this, Al Davis passed away, and Hugh Jackson was in Oakland, and he seized that power vacuum over the franchise and started making trades as the coach to save his job. He traded a first and a second for Carson Palmer because the owner had passed and he had taken over. The owner in Houston unfortunately passed. Bill O'Brien takes over, and look at what he's done as far as incoming and outgoing since he's been the general manager. Incoming Laremy Tunsil, Duke Johnson, Kenny Stills a third and a fourth. Outgoing Clowney, former number one overall pick, two firsts, a second, and a fourth. That is the ultimate. He is on his, he's on a credit card that he's like, hey, I might just walk away from the bill at the end of this anyway. It's always the risk when you have a coach who is coaching for his job, who also is the person in charge of the roster. You don't have to worry about tomorrow you, because tomorrow you might not be employed. So that's the Clowney, the process was bad. Tunsil, they got better, but that's a drastic overpay.
But let's just walk away with this. Is Deshaun going to be more protected this year than he was last year?
Listen, you have a guy that can be a perennial all-pro pro bowler in Laremy Tunsil. He's a guy that you can pencil into your roster for the next 10 to 15 years. He's going to provide stability to that offensive line. He's going to make not only himself better and Deshaun Watson better, but that entire offensive line better, because now you can slide the protection and leave him on that island. I think he's worth it. When you talk about a left tackle versus a good, not great, pass rusher, I think the great offensive tackle.
Oh, they got better for the 2019 season, but
and that's what it's all about. This league is wide open. This season is wide open.
Sure.
The AFC is wide open.
But lastly, just real quick, you mentioned him be there the next 10 to 15 years. Once again, in the infinite wisdom of Bill O'Brien, they, in doing the trade, he didn't agree to a contract extension. You don't think Laremy Tunsil is going to have ultimate leverage over this team when they traded two firsts, a second for him, and don't have a contract in place? I'm happy for Deshaun. I feel badly for my friends in Houston who the team might have mortgaged its future to save Bill O'Brien's job.
Texans need a general manager. Coming up.
I'm available.
Are the Cowboys, because you guys are probably both up for that. Are the Cowboys' frustrations
with Mike Mayock can get the job.
Worst hurt.
That's agenda. First things first.
I mean.
Yeah, I get the career path. First things first, general manager.
Exactly.